the convener in India of an organization called Aghaz-e-Dosti. And her input was so conciliatory and so coherent that I felt that we should have a gathering of young people who will express their views on foreign policy. Because in this institute, generations of older people have come to speak. But the youth have perhaps a new way, a different way of looking at foreign policy issues. And when I concluded, made my concluding remarks at that conference, I said that we should have maybe another conference in which young people can express their views. So this is the first step towards that possibility. And is this a list of speakers? They all want to speak? So now we have a very large list of speakers, and there are 16 here. Apart from, does this include Vajia? So we've got 16 speakers, and I think that we should limit it to 5 minutes to each, otherwise we will go into the late evening. And I want to start this with this event by asking Vajia Najam to open the discussion. She is a researcher of this institute and she has worked for us for a few years.
She had a call.
Where is she?
She had a call.
She had a call. Well, in that case, all right, Asif, we start with you. Asif also works for us.
Rather, we can take note on challenges. So, I would start that Pakistan has only one neighbor, and that is China. The rest cannot be justified as neighbors, because neighbors is altogether a different meaning and a very positive and deep meaning. So, Pakistan's foreign policy has not been independent and democratic throughout its history of 17 world years. And I would contradict to those who call half of history, because we have seen interventions throughout there. Well, a dictated foreign policy has never been to work in Pakistan. Now coming directly to them, our establishment, has a caretaker government, but the slight difference is that they don't leave us, and they are always watching us. They are behind us, showing us the way, where to go, but the way goes nowhere, actually. We have lost much of our national interest in the name of national security. As we all know that the national security rules don't come at cost of, do come at cost of, a hefty amount of, and 75% of, budget. To assume this, likewise, I would assume that no humiliation would have came our way if we had not launched a Babil ballistic missile in reflection of India's Agni 4, and Pakistan did it exactly after 20 days. And nothing would have happened if Pakistan would have not made this. And what more fascinating would have been if Pakistan had, Pakistan had dismantled one nuke from prevailing ones, the deterrence would have still prevailed. Either this would have been a shift in deterrence stability and all that. However, the point is that such a hefty expenditure must be overlapped with trade initiatives and other investments with also rivals like India, so-called. So to validate this point, we can trace history of China. When in 1980s, if I'm not wrong, in the Deng era, when China set aside its dispute and opened its door for all the concerned countries, and today we can see on a very visible scale that China is a global emerging country, and it is growing. So now, besides India, so we have engaged and we have a lot to do together, but we have to take extraordinary measures to, you know, merge our interests with China. So if, because if once the gap is created, it will be too far and it will be too late, you know, to compensate the Chinese interests and their opinion. And regarding this, one has rightly said that we can, anyone can fool the United States, but never the Republic of China.
Conclusively, these foreign policy shocks are in some way beneficial also, because these are the factors that we, from which the self-realization come, and one day maybe we stand up and redefine our foreign policy, and we will. So it is, I think, a high time that we should make new changes in Naya Pakistan. Thank you very much.
5 minutes.
Yes. My name is Vajiha Najam and I'm a research officer here, and my topic is foreign policy. Foreign policy is an aspect of national policy. If national governance is dysfunctional, foreign policy cannot deliver. This is because no foreign political framework for a successful foreign policy will be available. This is the norm in Pakistan. As long as Pakistan's military intelligence complex overwhelming civil and political society in terms of per capita resource allocations, strategic perceptions and policy influence, the national perspective will remain distorted. This negatively impacts on foreign policy. Free to dangerous with the other who. This places an enormous burden on the China-Pakistan relationship. A burden that analysts address a globally emerging China could find too distracting and risky to sustain. Pakistan is an important strategic partner for China, but an ungovernable Pakistan will not be able to maintain this partnership. CPEC scheme is a soft option to industrialize and modernize without the leadership having to provide good governance, human resource development, political reforms, and capacity building. With India, Pakistan seems to believe that merely blaming a blameworthy India instead of maximizing its longer-term foreign policy options through a development a good enough policy. Both India and Kashmir are inherently longer-term challenges for Pakistan. There are no short-term solutions. Moreover, there are no zero-sum solutions that favor Pakistan. However, a corrupt and dishonest leadership will never speak this truth because it has not got the moral standing to inform the people about diplomatic, economic, and military realities. It prefers to deceive them rather than develop the country to a point where it can negotiate with India and get international support for its stance on a more equal and effective basis. Should India remain arrogant and abrogate towards a more internationally credible Pakistan, and world would increasingly take note of it. Now, Afghanistan seems completely unable or unwillingly to learn that a one Taliban can never be a policy assert for it. Or maybe power centers have begun to involve with them to allow a realistic Afghanistan policy. Today there is an alliance of the US, Afghanistan and India against Pakistan. Moreover, Pakistan's standing throughout Afghanistan is at its lowest ever. Pakistan, whatever its reservations, has no option but to sustainably improve its relation with Kabul for peace in Afghanistan. Pakistan's fragile economy and failing rupee and rising external debt will require it to stand again, cap in hand, at the door of US dominant international financial institutions. Can CPEC deliver Pakistan from this beggary? It can help to a great extent provided Pakistan can help itself through decent governance and an independent and balanced foreign policy. Iran sees Pakistan as directly and indirectly under the thumb of its enemies. Saudi Arabia and the US It views Pakistan as an untrustworthy neighbor and a rival in Afghanistan. Accordingly, it is providing India as access to Afghanistan and Central Asia by passing Pakistan, developing confidence and cooperation between Iran and Pakistan is essential. Yep, I'm going to finish. So there are the crucial realities and we should address all before going to making our foreign policy and get some respective position internationally and regionally.
Thank you. That is very good. Thank you. Who is Amir Hussein or Amir Hussein?
He is spending on arms and ammunition purchase as same as 60 billion India on military purchase. Development of education, further development of scientific research in our country. So I would like to suggest here to the coming already elected and taking Prime Minister Imran that he should, but he must work on the normalization of relations with India. It will be in the best interest not only of the state but of the people of both states. Thank you very much.
Very good.
Assalamu alaikum.
I am
the researcher from the Pakistan University. And what I think is the foreign policy is the guideline which a country should have while dealing with the neighbors. I'm not talking about the neighbors only, but the globally, because we have to deal with the with not only with our neighbors, next door neighbors, or we definitely have to live in a global world. And then into certain things which are not serving our interest. Like if I'm talking about the helping those people to getting rid of. Some Russian invasions, but we think like our new government should have it. Definitely, they should retain our identity first. If we are the Muslim countries, definitely we should have a good relationship with the Muslim countries. We should not be thinking about it like the America is having got the good terms with Iran, so we should not be all those things. Or Saudi Arabia is not having the good terms with Iran, so we should not be. In good terms. So I would like that we should first we have the national interest that we have to serve. And we should have the policy which should solve the problems like within India. Like we've been fighting might be on the LOCs and in Kashmir and all those things. But we should think that we have never come to a point where we can solve our problems. They are also facing some problems, definitely we are. But we should be into the terms that we can solve our problems. They are also the growing economy. Definitely, they would like to see where they can solve the problems of their people. They have also facing the poverty like we are, or might be more. But definitely, there would be a certain thing that we can come across. The same thing with Afghanistan. We've been serving or suffering a lot by these Afghan war. So we should have the certain terms that we can solve the problems among these two countries. And we cannot forget the APS people, that how the brutally those people, the small children were killed. We have to come across where we can solve that we can save our civilian for that. The fighting might be going on the borders, but definitely our people, our civilians should also be in the mind where we can get the benefit of.
Of occasions where we saw that America only tried their level best to get benefit for them, and of course, at occasions they did support Pakistan, but on the cost of what? Our own internal security issues. Now it's a very tricky situation. Right now we are standing at a stage where on one side this is China, the CPAC, on the other side this is United States. I, while drafting this 5 minute talk, I was looking at what we should be doing in the next 10 years. I came across the statement of Mr. Asad Umar in 2016. He said, maybe for China, the CPAC road is to transfer the Chinese goods from China to Africa or many other parts of the world. But let's think ourselves as Pakistanis, we will use this road to transport our goods to other parts of the world. So maybe that is the angle that with which we have to look at the foreign policy in coming years. Now, another part is how to be more independent, because the very first question that I called was, are we independent in the foreign policy of Pakistan? And as I said, probably not. But how can we be independent? The first point on the list is get out from the IMF pledges, the World Bank pledges. The moment we reduce the loan, the debt that we have as Pakistanis on ourselves, I'm sure we will be slightly more independent in foreign policy decisions. The second thing is delegation of competent people in the foreign offices, maybe in Pakistan as well as in the foreign offices. People who are going as ambassador, if somebody is a retired general, maybe he's not having that exposure to the foreign aspects, foreign policy aspects. So we deputed delegate people to the foreign offices irrespective of their, in the world, so that we are able to build a better image of Pakistan across the world. Third thing on the list, how we can become more independent, is the focus on pragmatics rather than ironies. You know, we have a lot of problems. We have concerns of water with India. We are talking about dams that India is trying to construct. We are not talking about the dams that we have to construct. Probably we have to resolve our internal issues to the level that international world, the people sitting outside looking at our country, they should consider Pakistan as a responsible member of international society. So ultimately, and last but not the least, let's focus on academics, social and cultural issues that are there in the international world. We are talking about a lot of conflicts. We are getting into conflicts. That is what we have to do to become more independent in the foreign policy area. And hopefully I see a lot of light in coming years, and in 10 years, I see Pakistan improving a lot. Thank you very much.
Inability of any single country or a single block of countries to address global challenges of security and development. Pakistan's foreign policy successes are measurably outnumbered by failures. At present, Pakistan is surrounded by strange neighbors on all sides, save China. Our foreign policy has gone through many stages, from the perception of the security. With the superpower to the present state, where our hegemonic neighbor openly threats to isolate us in the international community. Now, there I would like to highlight few failures, causes of failures. Number one is civil military dressing. Pakistan's military has been playing the role of a guardian of the country's ideological boundaries. Hence, Pakistan's history of state building is marked by prolonged military rules and intermittently cut short stint of civilian governments. Largely, it was the civil incompetence or leadership void which allowed military a space in politics. The embryonic democratic process is trying to find a place in the country's complicated decision-making machinery where institutional roles collide and mandates overlap. Such interventionist approaches choke the space for alternative discourses and fresh thinking that are required in democracy. A greater say in countries' foreign policy making. So a never-ending struggle between military and political elite is a major cause behind the incompetent foreign policy. Another failure is the leadership void. Pakistan's institutional apparatus has failed to build capable leadership because those in power have here used abuse and exploit power to fulfill their personal interest. It is due to this void that too many people are poking their noses in foreign policy, resulting in incoherence and inaction. The biggest cause of country's failure in the realm of foreign policy. Third is dependence on Western Hemisphere. The need for security compelled Pakistan to join the United States camp, but it injured her status in the regional context. By aligning itself with the United States, the country alienated many countries in the South Asia region.
The Soviet Union
lobbying to further her interest in US, especially during the two diplomatic disasters, when America refused to subsidize an F-16 deal and openly campaigned to induct India into the NSG. Furthermore, Pakistan has not fully fought its case regarding recent atrocities in Kashmir on all available international platforms. On the contrary, India has...
Our nation never gets prosperous when its economy is continuously declining. As a youth, there are certain questions in my mind that I want to ask to the world. That why in domestic policy of Pakistan, economic strategies are not given importance. What Pakistan is doing to maintain the balance of power in Asia? And its allies are continuously being separated, like Afghanistan, India and Iran has recently signed a three-nation pact in Chabahar. And in my opinion, for the peace of the world, Iran and Saudi Arabia needs to resolve conflicts and Pakistan should work as the mediator. As we all know that when diplomacy is given the priority, then military options stands as the last resort. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Foreign policy means our intentions. What are our intentions? Foreign policy is actually our reflection of our domestic policy. Foreign policy is something which is made and which straddles around two environments. One is internal and the other is external. So one point we all have taken notice of is that three to four speakers before me, if I am not wrong, have repeated that point that we are having no neighbors. So why this neighbor, having a good neighbor is important? Why to have a buffer state or something like that is very important in international relations or strategics? This is because the external environment and our previous intentions, our previous decisions make up environment in which we are making our future decisions. So we all know that India is not a good neighbor, and Afghanistan and Iran are also not having good ties with us. China is the only country, is the only giant on which we are holding our back. So we cannot, as we all know, that of course nation states and national interest is the basic aim of the pursuing any foreign policy. So how can we think that China is going to help us in any difficult circumstances and dangers by putting its own national interest backward? So we cannot rely on anyone. So in that case, I am going to I can say that only the Arabian Sea is our buffer state. So why I want to raise my voice on the Kashmir issue. Why this Kashmir issue is not being resolved? Foreign policy, there is one indicator, like in science we have litmus test or other test. In international relations we have an indicator that if your present situation condition is not very much good, it means that your past history of foreign policy was not good. I don't need to convey any history of Pakistan's foreign policy. Our neighbors are not with us. So how can we say they're not even a minor reflection of our Kashmir issue, Kashmir struggle? Our brothers are struggling. But they, even with a minor struggle, they got independence. So what is the problem with us? Why are we not having this problem solved? So it is certainly the fault of our foreign policy. Then I want to say that ABS back, our colleague has mentioned about it. So like we can say that 9/11 was an attack on one nation by other any nation, any NGO or something like that, any cooperation or
access in the region. Like the America is going to have a free access and access in Iraq, now in Syria, and they have easy access in Afghanistan. Because of that, our regional policies, foreign policies, our diplomatic relations are very poor. So we have to focus on our diplomatic relation with the regional partners to strengthen our foreign policy. If we are going to weak and weaker, other international powers, international countries will get an easy access to threat your national security as well also. So please kindly focus on your regional relations, good diplomatic relations, if you really want to come in the global world picture as the best foreign policy producer in the world. A best leadership also.
Compulsory that Pakistan should discuss the Kashmir issue in the United Nations or international level. And Pakistan is facing water crisis. Pakistan is world's fourth country, which fourth water deficient country. It is prediction that till 2030, we will have more water crisis or water problems. So Pakistan, we should discuss this issue and we should go to solve this issue. And Next, we do not have diplomats in different foreign embassies of Pakistan, that we should discuss and diplomat different issues. As Kashmir issue, it is not been solving yet. So we did not discuss it in national level. It should be discussed in national level, that this is compulsory for the foreign policy of Pakistan. As well as the foreign policy, it plays important role in the development of any country. So these are the issues, and it has been discussed on this stage. So these must be solved, then Pakistan can develop and can progress
in Pakistan. So I intend expressing my views, highlighting first of all two distinct aspects. First of all, I shall talk about optimistic view, and then I shall go over to the pessimistic view, both sides of the coin. Optimistically, the present era has generated the acquaintance with each other through personal contacts. We cannot live in the dark. Everything is very clear and transparent. There has been the removal of cultural, social, and political obstacles. What we used to think about India 10 years or 15 years before, as the madam has very rightly pointed out, and it straightaway goes in my favor, in my perception, that the things are different now. It is the dismissal of misunderstanding. Again, with apologetically, this repetition, referring madam's point of view about Indian Navy. Familiarization with each other's problems, especially compulsions. India has a compulsion. We have a compulsion. Likewise, Americans, they do have compulsions. So we are living in the world of compulsions too. Identification of like-minded individuals, groups, and organizations. Fanaticism. They are moderate, they are lenient, and they want, they believe in pluralism. Development of a coherent group with exceptional influence in the world, internally, externally, and regionally. Without any wisdom, and this is how we have delegated our seniors or wise people at the backstage. Replacement of logic, rational and reasoning of an educated individual or class by the general public emotionally charged at a particular spur of moment. We do not believe in logic. We believe in the spur of the moment to take some decision, and which has all the chances to go wrong. Under these circumstances, gentlemen, I shall hurriedly go over what should be our foreign policy. We should not be specific country-wise. We should not be regional-specific. We are an independent country, and what should be our objective?
Can we come back to that when we go?
We
take it in the discussion in the way forward. Okay. So, thank you very much for your patience. What they are going to do in the future in the making of the foreign policy, especially with our neighbors. A lot has been said about Afghanistan, India, China. Interestingly, if you talk about China, China recently in an article in BBC, it was mentioned that China is the only country which has relation with Israel, Saudi Arabia, good relations I'm saying. Israel, Saudi Arabia, Iran, Syria, any country aside of the United States, they have very good relation because they made their foreign policy, they know what they are going to do. It's a soft power, so that's why they having the relation on the basis of the economy, and they gain what they want on the basis of the economy. If you talk about Pakistan, we cannot be a neutral one. Frank over here said that Pakistan is involved in the issue of Saudi Arabia and Canada. Interestingly, if you study the country of Pakistan with Saudi Arabia, we are related to Saudi Arabia because we, in the past, we have financial problems, and Saudi Arabia helped us, our administrations. In future, we also think of same thing. So beggars are not choosers. So it's not possible that we can make a neutral foreign policy when we are looking towards China, at the same time to IMF, same time to the Saudi Arabia. So first, we have to focus on it. Another thing, the role of think tanks. If you talk about Pakistan, the think tanks, specifically if you talk about think tanks, I'm not seeing any role of think tanks in the making of foreign policy, although we can see that the role of think tanks in the United States, in other countries of Europe. Why? It's a question mark in our making of foreign policy. There are some specific think tanks in Islamabad, especially I'd like to take an the National Defense University, they play an important part in the making of foreign policy.
So, and you know what, foreign policy is actually shaped are influenced by the internal crisis, and I prefer that the social institutions that in Pakistan are not working properly. So there's a need to maintain it, because when institutions work properly, there's like a development, advancement, and you know, stability, which would definitely gain the interest of foreigners to provide to invest their business over here, to which would actually promote the trade and industrial sectors as well, which would help us gain financial and financial and economic situation, and this would help us eradicate that. And I think this is a major issue which needs to be resolved.
They are saying rumor. Even we have did the three Zerbias, Abdul Fassad, for the sake of United States, that there is a terrorist group in Pakistan, Zerbia, and you must fight against them. On the word of them, we have fired, but still. Now, January Donald Trump's speech upset us that he said that we did big. That we cooperate with Pakistan. I said that Pakistan must clear his image in global. If I see the neighbor countries, we are for sanction. If we see our Saudi Arabia, Canada has both the sanction of Saudi Arabia, and see Iran and Turkey. So I said that Pakistan must support Islamic countries, and we must have one global of Islamic countries that we should say, we should give a good message to us that. In each and every stage, we are being targeted like Middle East and South, these countries like Afghanistan, Pakistan. All the world are seeing these countries which we used to say that they are being sacrificed, but nobody is seeing that they are sacrificed. If I talk about the Iran, America is being a sanction on Iran.
And the fourth one, which is very important, that balancing between the right Muslim wing and the left Muslim wing. Like Shia or Sunni religious countries in the world. So these are the four, I think, for the basic principle for the new government of Pakistan, and how they cope up with these four principles. I think the first and the foremost important thing is the formulation of foreign policy. We are lacking from since 71 years that we are not making foreign policy by the foreign policy experts. The foreign policy made by those people who don't know how to make foreign policy or what is the foreign policy. So if people who want to enter in the process of foreign policy, they should come up for whether they are Kalai Makhluk or Alaki Makhluk or Agriculture Department or whatever. If they want to be the part of the foreign policy, they come up for. Not only for the rewards, but also for all the discomfort of failures in front of the people. So I think then might be the foreign policy will be more objective or more successful. Secondly, the new Prime Minister, Imran Khan Sahab, is very charming and very attractive to all over the world. Why not he use that fame for the betterment of Pakistan? Because he is more acceptable than any other prime minister of Pakistan. So we can use it in a good way. Whether we like it or not, he is the prime minister of Pakistan. So we can use it in a better way. Next, the media. The power of the media used by United States, used by India. We already saw that. Why don't we use it for improving the relationship of Pakistan with all over the world?
For me, it's quite something that I, and the only deterrence we have is the nuclear weapons. The other thing is that there has been a lot of attack on the poor ambassadors of Pakistan, and that many of the young people have said that they are not up to the mark, and that they don't make the foreign policy, but ambassadors never make foreign policy. Ambassadors only help to implement the foreign policy that comes to them from the headquarters. They are not leaders of foreign policy, they only implement foreign policy. They get the instructions from the Foreign Office and they work accordingly. So that is something that you must keep in mind before you run down the poor ambassadors. And I don't think we've had bad ambassadors, we have had brilliant ambassadors. I was not so brilliant and I don't like being taunted like that. But we have had brilliant ambassadors. There has been E. Rakram, absolutely outstanding. Our present Foreign Secretary, Jamila Janjua, she was our representative in New York as well as in Geneva. She is absolutely outstanding. And there have been many others. Like Aga Shahi, there are many there. Riaz Kokar, our Sabhi, these are outstanding ambassadors. So, I mean, yes, there are some political appointees, but most of them have done very well. Done very well for a country which had domestically very little to say for itself. So we should, welcome, we should appreciate that.
We should use our media to forward our foreign policy. We should pick up Twitter and all these different mediums to, improve our image in the world. And I also think that we have been taking a very traditional history of doing diplomacy up till now. It's mostly the ambassadors who've been, doing the diplomacy for us with different institutions. Now, because of social media, each of us is a diplomat.
Actually, all very useful, particularly the social media. But the underpinnings of, and I'm delighted that a number of people mentioned it without enough emphasis, that the underpinning of the foreign policy is the domestic policy, your national policy. Do we place enough emphasis on education, social welfare, health? Well, then your bank has been done. When you have all pillars of your credit, you have to take it up. Then they open themselves to the world. Then they open the next. तो ये हमारे लिए बड़ा जरूरी है और इसके लिए जैसे राष्ट्रपति ने भी कहा संजय ने भी कहा ऑल ऑफ अस आर इन दैट एंड वी नीड टू हैव आवर वॉइस हर्ड वो बड़ा इम्पोर्टेंट था इन दैट वर्ल्ड दैट वी नीड टू ग्रुप आवरसेल्व्स इनटू अ वॉइस दैट कैन बी हर्ड बट इट शुड बी कोहेरेंट अगर आपको
आप दस दस बार सुनते हैं फ्लाइंग मखलूक कहना ये वो दे मे हैव देयर ओन शेयर मुझे बताइए दुनिया में कौन सा वो मुल्क है इंक्लूडिंग अमेरिका और रशिया जो अपनी पॉलिसी जब बनाता है तो उसके अंदर उनकी इंटेलिजेंस एजेंसी और उनकी डिफेंस एजेंसी उसमें थिकली इन्वॉल्व रहती है कहीं मुझे आप बताइए इंडिया में ले लीजिए आप जब वाजपेयी साहब एक इंडिपेंडेंट कोशिश कर रहे थे जो बनाने की तो उनको बाकायदा फोर्सबली रोका गया और आपने सुना होगा कि एक ड्राफ्ट बना हुआ था वो ड्राफ्ट जो है वो इट कुड नॉट मूव फॉरवर्ड और उसके अलावा बहुत कहानियाँ हैं कि इंदिरा गांधी साहब को उसके आर्मी इंडियन आर्मी चीफ ने किसी बात को ये कहा था कि अगर आप अपने हदूद में रहिए तो हम अपने हदूद में रहेंगे वरना मसले कुछ सीरियस हो सकते हैं सो ये इस तरह नहीं हुआ करता जब एक मुल्क चलाते हैं तो उसकी मैं बहुत से इंटरेस्ट तो आपको तमाम इंटरेस्ट को देखते हुए शेयर करना पड़ता है जो पिछले 10 साल में जो हमने तमाशा देखा है वो तो इट्स एक्सट्रीम विकॉन्ट ऑन ए कंट्री लगता है कि जिसमें चंद चार आदमी बैठ के और पूरे मुल्क क्योंकि एक्सट्रीम कॉम्प्लेक्स कंट्री आप एक ये भी ख्याल कीजिए कि हम कंपेयर करना तो शुरू करते हैं चाइना अमेरिका रशिया तारीखी तौर पे ना मुल्क है ना कौम, हमें तो अभी बनाना है। कायदे आजम ने सिर्फ आपको एक कौम के तौर पे जगह देके एक कौम के टाइटल दे दिया आपको, और कौम तो आपको बाद में बनानी थी 47 के बाद, वो तो अपना आज तक काम नहीं किया। तो हम वी स्टार्ट कंपेयरिंग इट विद अदर कंट्री, और ये जो सुनते रहते हैं ना कि इंडिया अफगानिस्तान ईरान किसी से आपके ताल्लुकात उस वक्त तक ठीक नहीं होंगे जब तक आप मुआशी तौर पे और एक कौम के तौर पे मजबूत ना हो और आपकी जो जो भी ज़रूरियात हैं उनके ऊपर आपका यकीन होना चाहिए। कश्मीर की बात करते हैं, कश्मीर इज नॉट दैट सिंपल प्रॉब्लम विच कैन बी सॉल्व। आप अपना सब कुछ दे दें तभी वो कश्मीर आपको देगा। कारगिल आपका था, आपने वापस लिया था, व्हाट हैपेंड टू यू? क्या आप में से कोई उठा उसने कहा हो कि हाउ कैन यू गिव इट बैक? सियाचिन आपका था, दे हैव टेकन ओवर, कैन यू डू एनीथिंग? सर जी नो प्लीज, आपको इंडिया और पाकिस्तान के रिलेशन के ऊपर जब आप बात करेंगे तो आपको पहले पूरी तारीख को जानना पड़ेगा, और तारीख आपकी बहुत खतरनाक है। हमारी मतलब तुम्हारी जिम्मेदारी मतलब हमारी तारीख नहीं, इस खत्ते की तारीख, उसके ऊपर आपको नजर
डालनी। But one thing I agree with Sikandar Saab very well, that if a country is economically very strong, they can develop a very strong foreign policy. What we refer about China, China is powerful because of the economy. Because, you know, read the Jinping's recent statement which he has issued, and he said that I'm not going to tolerate any corruption, you know, in Chinese society, and I will eliminate those people. What's happening in Pakistan? 10 years, Zardari 10%, 100%, Nawaz Sharif, oh my God, it's a flow of money from Pakistan to outside and buying the properties and making Pakistan weaker and weaker. So Imran Khan is going to inherit a Pakistan which is full of problems. And I assure you that people like you, the young people who speak so fluently about the foreign policy and about the economic issues and about the future of Pakistan and the strength of Pakistan, I'm very sure that they will help Pakistan grow as a strong nation and will not go into a sectarian issue like Urdu, Sindhi, Pathan, Balochi. They will just see that they are Pakistanis and they will make Pakistan strong and strong.
तो इस जो रुझान को जो है क्लियर करना बहुत ज़रूरी है, क्योंकि ये नौजवानों के जहन में ये जो एक रिफ्ट है मेरे ख्याल में ये मुस्बत नहीं है। इसको क्लियर होना चाहिए कि अगर ऐसा है तो क्यों है, उसकी क्या वजूहत है।
Hundreds of other countries, each having its own interests. And what I would like to add to what has been said is that history and the behavior of a nation is also very important. The history of the decade, what was Karachi foreign policy? Somebody mentioned it quite rightly. I'll just repeat that friendship holds on. And added to that was another phrase, enmity towards none. Friendship towards all, enmity towards none. But what happened? Khadazan died. The Arab tried to follow it, what happened to him? Khadazan Asmati tried to follow it, what happened to him? And then Muhammad covered with the help of civil servants. And of course, the backing of his father, Chief Justice Munir, who they said, post-sentiment of this country, your whole history changed from that day. Why? I'll just explain to you very briefly. The first thing which he did was to have a defense pact with America, Baghdad pact, against Soviet Union. It went against your basic tenet of your elders. Friendship towards all, enmity towards none. Why did it become friendship? A politician no experience. Other than Nadmuddin himself told that to a couple of field servants who went to consultate him. He said, we have no experience. He was only Muslim leader who had had a chief minister's job. Nobody else in Muslim League at the time of the ruling. So he said, we have no experience. The administration, help us. And if you help us correctly, that was his word explained to me. These were his words. He said, if you help us, then democracy will flourish. But if you don't, then and unfortunately, they thought, why we carry things on our shoulders, we'll do it ourselves. And they took over in 53. And as a result of this, they decided to form three things in Pakistan. One is the ATAC of civil servants, who will deal with the civil aid and civil matters. And the GHQ will deal directly with petrol and press matters. And see, they said, since we have to sell it, sell the aid to Pakistan to the American people, we must have a facade of democracy. And who are the best people for the facade of democracy? You know that. They are the president of politicians. They are the people who are picked up by the establishment. They are doing the job. But they are not supposed to make money for themselves. They are not worried about you and the people. Anyway, so that is our history as to what. Now, coming to the national behavior, they are hypocrites from top to the bottom. We call it democracy. Do you have students' union? Do you have labor union? Do you have basic local bodies? So how can you have the favor of God? It doesn't like hypocrites. It's started to look up. But, I mean, that's basic problem which we are facing today. And then there was
After studying classical realism and neoclassical realism approaches to foreign policy, there is really need to have smart diplomacy and the promotion of national interests while functioning within the framework of accountability for Pakistan to revive our relations with our neighbors.
Pakistan's foreign policy should be to seek recognition as a responsible state working for peaceful and prosperous world. And there are, in my opinion, four factors, and I'm very pleased, I'm very confident, and I'm grateful to my seniors that all have been included and they have been highlighted, and it reinforces my knowledge. The first is history. Second is geography, and third is technological age. I repeat, technological age in which we are surviving. And we have four governing principles. First of all is self-reliance. Second is coexistence. Third is pluralism. And fourth one is slightly debatable, but I have given it a practical shape, that is realpolitik.
You have also heard your seniors, General Sikandar Hayat and Admiral Iqbal Khadir, both of whom are very senior members of this institute. They have a wealth of experience behind them, not only in study and research, but also in the way in which they serve the state of Pakistan. You know, we quote our founding fathers, but we should also remember that the world has changed since the time that our founding fathers founded this country. Everything has changed. The realities of international politics have changed. The emergence and demise of superpowers has changed. Now we have one superpower, which is, as somebody rightly said, everybody's neighbor. So how our founding fathers would have dealt with the situation is a big question mark for me, I don't know. Again and again, the young people here said that we should work in the national interest, but all governments do really work in the national interest. It's just that their perception of the national interest may not be what it should be, or what we think it should be, but they think they are working in the national interest. And I'm saying that because I have also been a career citizen. But there is no doubt about the fact that if Pakistan had not cut such a sorry figure in its domestic affairs, it would have made a much more significant contribution to its foreign policy interests. because if a country is so fragile internally with respect to its institutions, with respect to lack of pluralism, with respect to its inability to tolerate dissent, with respect to its economic performance, then it is not possible for it perhaps to have done better than it did. But even so, in spite of all this, I think that our diplomats, some of them, most of them, somebody you mentioned the diplomacy, they did very well, and they were stalwarts. But however, thank you very much for making this such a very rewarding session, and as usual at the end of it, I want to invite you to come.